Hi, my name is Stephanie, and today I want to go over an article with you. So, a lot of times you may have heard that people say that it is said a lot in the autism community or the autistic community that once you have met an autistic, you have met an autistic. So a lot of times when they say, like, when you've met one type of person, you've met them all, they're all, like, very similar. In this case, people are trying to say, like, when you meet one autistic person, that person is so individually them that you couldn't really compare them too much with another autistic person. Yes, there are plenty of similarities, and that's obviously how we can get diagnoses, but all the little things are very individual to them. And we've also seen this with science. We've seen kind of conflicting studies with over and under actions kind of going on in the brain, more connections, less connections in different areas. We haven't always seen a consensus when it comes to that kind of thing in science. Now, we have seen that obviously there is a neurotypical brain, what we call a neurotypical brain, and a neuroatypical brain. And a lot of times people kind of argue, well, the neurotypical and the neuroatypical doesn't really matter because all of our brains are different. And while that is true, absolutely, all of our brains are different, this article is actually really helpful in shedding light on that kind of ordeal. This article was published early 2015. It says, in people with autism spectrum disorder ASD, no two brains are alike when it comes to connectivity between regions, scientists have found, which is in stark contrast to the relatively uniform ways the brains of people without autism are arranged. See, this is very interesting because, again, with that whole argument of, well, neurodiversity or having neurodiverse brains or whatnot isn't that big of a deal because everyone's brain is different, well, we're seeing that there is a neurotypical kind of brain set where you can kind of put those all together in a group. The discovery was made by a team from the Weizmann Institute of Science in Israel and could explain why some studies have found evidence that people affected by autism have overly connected brains, while others have characterized ASD as a result of reduced connections in several regions, both inside and outside of the cortex. So again, this helps us understand why we have conflicting science concerning the autistic brain, and this is also going into why people are trying to say that there are autisms, like different types of autism, because of different types, the way the brains work. However, in this article, they're saying there's not really a clear, obvious subtype of autism from this particular study, so we'll look into that. The team looked at five large data sets of functional magnetic resonance or imaging MRIs scans taken of high functioning adults with ASD and controls that were not affected by the disorder. The scans were taken at various universities around the US and while each individual was at rest. Resting state brain studies are important because that is when patterns emerge spontaneously, allowing us to see how various brain areas naturally connect and synchronize their activity, said one of the team, Avital Hahemi or Hahemi, I don't know, in a press release. When they compared the brains of the controls, so scans from people without autism, they found a standardized pattern of functional connectivity across each of them. This is where we get that concept of a neurotypical brain, because you will see a kind of a standard function going on in the brain across different neurotypical brains. If you superimpose one on top of the other over and over, the levels of connectivity across the various regions of the brain would look basically the same. So not identically the same, again, all of our brains are different, but basically the same. Certain regions had high interhemispheric between the right and left sides connectivity, primary sensory motor regions like the sensory motor cortex and the occipital cortex, writes Diana Gittig at Ars Technica. Others showed low interhemispheric connectivity, regions like the frontal cortex and temporal cortex, which are involved in the in higher order association. Overall, the control brain scans looked pretty much the same as each other. But when they compared the brains of people with ASD, they couldn't find any similarities between them in terms of where functional connectivity would be typically high and where connectivity would be low. In fact, they say it's not even really about the weakness and strengths of the connections, but rather the topology of the neural networks, so how they're arranged. The team suggests that the fact that no two ASD brains they studied were the same could be a core characteristic of high-functioning ASD. So again, this is basically science confirming the statement that when you meet one autistic, you literally just met that one autistic, because quite frankly, our brains are so different that they're not finding a consistent pattern to be able to, like, subtype them. They couldn't even split the brains up into subgroups because because the way the networks were arranged was so idiosyncratic and individualized, but note that an analysis for larger datasets could eventually uncover clustering of similar characteristics and connectivity patterns. Our results reveal a new and robust abnormality in the ASD connectivity, which relates to the topographical nature of the functional connectivity patterns rather than to their overall strength. The team reports in the journal Nature Neuroscience. Specifically, we found that the canonical pattern of functional connectivity seen in typical controls showed significant and individually distinct or idiosyncratic distortion in participants with ASD. The team isn't sure what causes the brain connectivity in people with ASD to essentially go off and do its own thing, and because they only study the brains of adults, they're not sure when this idiosyncratic distortion is likely to occur, but they suggest that it could be the result of how people interact and communicate from their environments on an everyday basis. From a young age, the average typical person's brain networks get molded by intensive interaction with people and the mutual environmental factors, says Hayhemi in the press release. Such shared experiences could tend to make the synchronized patterns of the control group's resting brains more similar to each other. It is possible that in ASD, as interactions with the environment are disrupted, each one develops a more uniquely individualistic brain organization pattern. Sure, it'd probably be far easier to understand how this disorder develops if we were able to form a standardized template of what the brain of a high-functioning adult with ASD should look like, instead of what we actually have, which is a bunch of highly individualized patterns, but it's incredibly valuable to finally get a sense of why conflicting studies on connectivity exist. It offers something entirely new to investigate as scientists try to figure out where it comes from and what those living with it are experiencing. Okay, so I found that particularly interesting because I firmly believe that each autistic person is basically perceiving the world in a unique and different and special way. And whether that sometimes can be overloading and frustrating and difficult to communicate, I think that it is also kind of a beautiful and diverse thing. So it is very interesting, again, to see that really, even though autistics tend to be able to share similar experiences, similar feelings, similar reactions to things, down to what's the most sensitive to them, down to whether they can handle human interaction in a certain way for a certain amount of time, how many people they can handle in the room, like all those sorts of things are so highly individualized. And it looks like it has to do a lot with how our brains work. And it does make me wonder if some of those things have to do with people who felt compelled and forced to mask, because they're talking about high functioning autistics, of course, then you are also dealing with that not actually being a term that is used in the diagnostic process. So what they consider high functioning is a bit like loose in my opinion, but it's an interesting thing to look into and know that we are very highly individualistic in how our brain works. And in that sense, it's really not fair for people who are neurotypical to determine how we should think or how we should perceive things, because for them, the neurotypical response, while obviously individual, is much more standard, much more standardized in general than the autistic experience. So that's really interesting to me. I thought you might be interested in it. Sorry, this one's a bit of a short video, just kind of on an article, but I wanted to share it with you and give you a video this week. So if you enjoyed it, go ahead and leave a like. Let me know all of your thoughts in the comments below. And if you enjoy hearing autism-related content from me, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I try to upload every Thursday at 4 p.m. Central Standard Time. I hope you're having a wonderful week, and see you in my next video. Bye!